From the Lake Oconee Studios, this is a program connecting faith and real life. This is God Talk. You can join the conversation right now by calling 706-453-4140. That's 706-453-4140. Now, your host of God Talk, Reverend David Key and Greg Tantum.
Good morning to you, and for the first time in a couple of weeks, Reverend David Key is with us, the globe-trotting This is God Talk. David is here, but your luggage is not.
My luggage is not. Let me warn everybody, going through Canada, you can lose your luggage. So don't ever take a trip going somewhere through Canada because you may not make it there. But coming home, you know, luckily I have my own supply of stuff here. So I can wait on the luggage here, not like it if it had happened in Italy. So, but it's good to be home. I was able to modern technology to be able to hear both shows. And sounded like y'all had some good guests here the last 2 weeks.
We had two great guests, but we missed you.
Proud of it. Well,
I think you would have enjoyed both to join the party with us.
Well, you know, global trotting, I really do love my life, and I love where I live, and I love the dynamics around it, and so to come home is not a problem, and it's always a pleasure, so it's good to be back here with you all.
And this is God Talk, to explain it. This is kind of where our weekly conversation with Reverend David Key, the founding pastor of Lake Oconee Community Church, a little church by the lake during this time of year. And we just sort of talk about the week and God. And later this morning at 10 o'clock, we will be on the Bulldog, which during the week does sports. So I sort of make it, on the weekend they're doing sports talk, and then they have the talk program during the week. But so for the sports fan, I say God Talk is sort of like at the end of the week watching game films with the with a big head coach up in the sky, and see if he can help us with any X's and O's on moving forward into the next week and dealing with some of the craziness that the world continues to throw at us. But in all seriousness, it is a conversation just about how we live in the secular world, where the fact of the matter is faith and reality, you know, they don't stop at the church, at the church or the synagogue door.
Not at all. No, it's very much integrated in.
And we always want you to join the conversation with us, whether you just have something to add to whatever conversation we're on at the time, or you know, perhaps give us an idea. Our number is 706-453-4140. Well, let's start. I thought it was interesting because I followed some of your travels on Facebook and a couple of the texts you'd send. And what I thought, particularly in view of you being a pastor, but also now with the show, and because we do talk about current events in the world, looking at our life here in the United States from the outside in.
Sure, yes, and I do think every time you get to go overseas in any part of the world and look back, you do see the difference between our culture and the culture of other people, to say the least. You know, I highly recommend a trip to Europe. I took a cruise around the Adriatic Sea, beginning in Venice and ending in Rome. So I was on a cruise for most of the trip, and then added 2 days prior to the cruise in Venice, and then 2 days after the cruise in Rome. So a total of about 16 days that I was gone, with the majority of it being on the water on a cruise boat. But the thing about going to Europe, you know, I always recommend that Christians, you know, should go to the Holy Land at least once. They should go to Israel, see the kind of biblical story, see the landscape, see the geography, get a sense of understanding of kind of where the scripture was written. So go to the Holy Land, do it. I did that 40 years ago, was transformative, or actually 30 years ago, excuse me. I did that 30 years ago, transformative in my kind of understanding of Scripture. And of course, being a Protestant minister, Scripture, you know, I've spent years in seminary. Scripture's always been the important kind of dynamic there. In addition to Scripture, you have church history, which occurred after Scripture was written and up until now. And that's where you get the benefit of Rome and of Italy and of Europe, of understanding parts of church history that have occurred within the last 2,000 years, or last 1,900 years since Scripture was written. And so that's what I was able to be on, because this is the first time I'd ever been to Italy or to any part of that part of the world. I had not been to any of it. It was a huge bucket list. Now, I'm not the student of church history the way I am a student of Scripture. At my seminary, where I went to the Southern Baptist Theological Seminary, we rushed to the Protestant Reformation. So, you know, we had one semester of 1,500 years of church history, and then we had another semester of 400 years of church history. And so it was kind of a little uneven. So I didn't get the appreciation of those first 1,500 years being a Protestant as much, I'm sure, as I would have, I'm sure, if I'd have been a Roman Catholic right. priest. And so going back to here, I was kind of reliving church history. I knew enough church history, but it really did kind of bring alive what has been preserved basically since 300 AD. Especially in Rome, since that point, because I do think the Roman Catholic Church takes care of property and takes care of the kind of institutionalized dynamics of it, and then you kind of experience it. So, starting off in Venice, in the Marcus Plaza, you know, where the tomb of St. Mark the Evangelist is. And so you have church, and I went to church there. I actually went the mass service there in the place where St. Mark's wow. body is located. So you're doing that in Venice. And then I went to the Amalfi Coast at one point during the cruise. And then Amalfi, that is where the Apostle Andrew is and his remains. And so it's kind of the honoring of Andrew and all in the cathedral there in Amalfi. Again, a striking cathedral. So you're kind of going to all these locations where you have these individuals who are there. We were in where Paul was shipwrecked during his shipwreck days, 3 years that he was there in Malta. And so, again, there's a Catholic church there that has where he was shipwrecked there. And so you're kind of living the experiences, the geography, as with the Holy Land, Israel would be. You're living the geography of the experience in places that these things actually occurred. Yeah. And and so it's fascinating. It was a very spiritual experience.
Yeah, ask about that. Because it's also kind of fun to be in Italy.
It's fun to be in Italy.
So good we went
where pizza was discovered. We went where fettuccine Alfredo was discovered.
Yeah, I don't forgive you for posting that picture.
It's a gorgeous picture. I'm not a huge fan of fettuccine Alfredo. I really don't like that particular pasta here in the United States, but I ate it over there because of it being the place. I like our pizza better. I think to America, got to Chicago, got to New York. I think they created better pizza than what is in Italy. But you wanted to go where it was founded. So those things are there.
And you certainly didn't say that when you were there.
I didn't say a word of that, or they didn't understand me when I did say it. But there are churches in every corner. There are churches all over Rome, and the churches are more striking than our churches here, because everything precedes 200 years.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, you know, here we're lucky if a place has something 200, 300 years old, and there it's 500, 1,000. It's the neighborhood churches. It's not even the famous, huge locations that have all the unbelievable antiques and portraits and dynamics that you know are worth millions of dollars sitting in those cathedrals. Which I went to several of the neighborhood churches, it is just ornate, and someone's still opening the door for prayers. No one's in the cathedrals of Europe and all that. In a way, that's true. And we'll talk maybe a little later today about how that's becoming true in the United States. And we have to be careful. But over there, you know, someone is still opening the door for morning prayers. So I was still able to go in at 7 o'clock in the morning or, 6:30, 7:30. And was able to go into this magnificent facility of beauty. See, I think that's what really separates us a lot from the Europeans, or at least older experience than the Europeans, is this dynamic about beauty. And maybe it's what separates Roman Catholicism from Protestantism, is there's an appreciation to say we're going to invest multi-generationally into the beauty of this space. And I'm talking about investments of millions and millions of dollars doing that. We Protestants don't appreciate that as much and don't do it as much. I mean, even in this state, I mean, you go to the cathedral in Savannah, you're going to experience beauty because it's a gorgeous cathedral down in Savannah if you've not been there. It doesn't, you know, it's not up there with the level of the European ones.
Right.
But for America, I mean, it really is a place of beauty. And so in all these cathedrals that I went through and churches that I went through, you know, you find God in those places. Now, you also find God listening to Don Elliott's show on Talk 103.9. Because gospel music, you can find God in the middle of that. Morning when I'm listening to what Don and them produce and what other radio stations produce as far as going, I find God in that experience. I find God at the shores of Lake Oconee Sunday after Sunday after Sunday. So in all of those places you do it, I would argue you do find it in the cathedrals of Europe if you're looking for it. And that for me was just, I mean, it was one of those kind of spiritual, I won't call it a pilgrimage because I didn't make it to Assisi and some of the places you need to make it if you're going to do a pilgrimage. But as far as Rome is concerned, if you're a Roman Catholic or an Anglican or a Lutheran or anybody who appreciates high church,
right,
you need to go. My words are totally inadequate to describe those pieces. And if that's your religious tradition or you have an inkling in that way, you need to go. You know, I'm not sure, you know, the Christian church today and the evangelical, and again, we'll get to this later in the segment, you know, the warehouses that are getting built for this will last this generation. And, you know, we don't even own a own facility. And so, yeah, for the present moment, I think that makes it, and we do what we need to do in the present moment. But is someone 500 years from now going to know that we existed or that this was a place of God's worship or whatever? I think that's a real question. And that, I know they call it cathedral building. And cathedral building is the fact that you build this cathedral even though you may never worship in this cathedral. And that dynamic of doing that, moving these stones and doing all this kind of stuff took 100 years. So there were people that worked on it who never got to worship in it. We don't think that way here. You know, we want a little bit quicker, you know, kind of gratification of whatever we build and whatever we're going to do. We want to have it immediate. And that's the interesting thing about Europe is there is this kind of time frame that sees generationally how Christianity moves, and they can look back historically and see 1500 right, 2000 years of that happening. And this is my role in it in 2022 for whatever happens 2000 years from now. And so it's an interesting kind of perspective that we Americans, you know, I'm not sure we emphasize that as much here, and that would be a question.
We're going to continue that conversation. You're listening to God Talk. If you want to join the conversation, call 706-453-4140. This is God Talk on the voice and the talk of Lake Oconee.
Chris's Barbershop and Styling Salon, you get a world-class haircut in an old-school barbershop atmosphere. Plus, Chris has partnered with Anna's Massage Therapy, offered at both convenient locations, 669 Old Phoenix Road in Eatonton near the car wash, and in Madison at 1410 Eatonton Road. Open 6 days a week. For Anna's Massage Therapy, call 678-615-0943. Chris's Barbershop and Styling Salon in Eatonton and Madison, making the Lake Country beautiful one haircut at a time.
Your home protects your family and everything you love. When it's time to replace your roof and siding, think Green Tree Metals, the leader in manufacturing metal roofs and siding since 2008 for residential, commercial, and industrial customers. Their products are durable, strong, high-performing, and affordable. And when you choose Green Tree Metals, you're buying direct from the manufacturer, and that savings is passed on to you. For a free consultation and tons of reviews, log on to greentreemetals.com. That's greentreemetals.com, the coolest roof around.
No one does it quite like Main Street Furniture in downtown Greensboro. With two large floors of showroom space, everything smartly displayed means customers have plenty of name brand furniture, bedding, and accessories to choose from, ready to be delivered to your home today. Combine that with over 20 years of knowledgeable local service, and that makes Main Street Furniture your go-to furniture store in the Lake Area. At Main Street Furniture on South Main Street in downtown Greensboro.
A special message from the Humane Society of Morgan County. They're looking for dedicated people with a love and passion for animals. Available now, part-time technician positions. Daytime openings for the dog care and the cat care teams. Look for Humane Morgan on Facebook or send your resume to info@humanemorgan.org. You can also apply in person at 1170 Fairground Road in Madison. They're hiring now. The Humane Society of Morgan County, Madison's no-kill animal shelter.
If it has to do with garage doors, the Garage Door Doctor USA has it covered. They offer garage door sales, service, and installation with fast, reliable, affordable, and local service. The Garage Door Doctor, from their close-by showroom on Scott Road, proudly serves Greensboro, Madison, Eatonton, Milledgeville, and beyond. Trust the hundreds of happy customers throughout the area. Call 706-816-7199. That's 706-816-7199.
Here comes one run. Here comes another run.
Your world champion Atlanta Braves are on the hunt for a repeat. And Doc 103.9 has every pitch, every hit, and every home run.
Ball hits one to deep left center field, scorched through the air, and out of the ballpark.
Braves baseball on Doc 103.9 is brought to you in part by these local businesses.
Beeler Tree Service, online at BeelerTrees.com. DMD Garage Doors and Outdoor Living, online at DMDGD.com. Green County Farm Bureau on South Main Street in Greensboro.
Lightning strikes twice, and the Braves walk it off.
World champion Atlanta Braves baseball is on Doc 103.9.
You're listening to God Talk, live on Doc 103.9, the voice of Lake Oconee.
And I'm Greg Tandem with Reverend David Key, founding pastor of Lake Oconee Community Church. Fresh back from a trip to Italy, to Rome, quite an adventure.
There were some others. It was the Adriatic Sea, so I was in Croatia and Albania and Greece. And I actually, I'm not a huge shopper. Shopping is not. I'm really, as the language says, I'm trying to tread lightly on materialism and on gathering stuff at this stage of my life. And so I don't go buying lots of stuff. I did make one purchase, and that is an icon of St. Nicholas in Mykonos. I was in Mykonos, Greece. I just missed Elon Musk. He was there at some point getting sunburned prior to us getting there, just a day or two. So either he was on his yacht or he had already left by the time we got there. But in Mykonos, I got into a shop that had all this iconographic dynamics. I mean, numbers and numbers of icons everywhere at Greek Orthodox. And I got my Christmas decorations. It's a St. Nicholas icon that I will host in my house, and that will be my Christmas decorations from now on.
If it comes back with your luggage.
If it comes back with my luggage.
Earlier you might not have heard David's luggage is still on tour.
And it's on tour. It got a little longer.
It's got an extension.
It stayed in Montreal longer than I did. So, yes, to say the least. But yeah, that was my purchase, and then in Malta was also an interesting experience. So all of that was outside of Italy, and I have to say though, my heart is in Italy in some ways. I do think the Italians preserve and showcase their historical items better than the Greeks do. And of course, the Greeks will blame the French and the English for stealing all their stuff.
Right.
But the Italians have known how to recapture history. And if you've not been in several years around the Colosseum, developing all the kind of historical pieces leading to the Colosseum, and my brother, who was on the trip with me, had been, 10 years ago, and he says there have been major shifts and major development even in the last 10 years, and striking. I mean, just huge buildings and showcase dynamics of all that kind of Roman history outside of the Roman Catholic Church. So if you're into that, you can go see that as well.
What strikes me just now when you're having that conversation, and I guess somewhat being a contrarian at times, you hear that. And in our country, we're tearing down any controversial, in many cases, tearing down controversial statues and stuff of a past of individuals that, you know, were not necessarily the nicest people in the world. Is that in conflict? Is that in conflict with when you think of Jesus Christ and suddenly we're enhancing the glorification of the Romans? Who, quite frankly, persecuted?
Sure, they dominated the world.
I mean, is there conflict there, or do they understand that? Okay, this was, you know, it's terrible, but on the other hand, appreciate perhaps a godly inspired talent for architecture.
Well, you know, history, most historians will tell you that you study history so you don't repeat the mistakes.
Right.
That's the key to it. And so one of the challenges, I think, that we've seen recently is people who want to erase parts of history. The Germans, you know, post the Holocaust, were very clear to make sure that they didn't honor the Holocaust, but they also didn't forget the Holocaust. So I think we should be more nuanced in our understanding of our history, the parts of our history that we don't appreciate, and we certainly shouldn't be glorifying, but I also don't think we need to ignore it, because the reality is if we ignore what happened in this country, you know, slavery being a huge issue, other things can come in our history, in our future, that could resemble slavery if we forget about slavery.
Right.
So I think we instead need to make sure that we're being honest about the dynamics around slavery, and we certainly don't need to honor the lost cause. I mean, the lost cause is not a accurate description of the Civil War. It isn't accurate. See, it was something that was developed post the Confederacy and post the Civil War to kind of maintain certain power structures within Southern states, and it was quite successful for about 80 years. That they were keeping civil rights from different folks, and they were keeping people basically enslaved through other dynamics. And the lost cause was kind of a religious dynamic that served that purpose, very similar to apartheid in South Africa. You saw the same religious dynamic with Dutch reform in South Africa that maintained that for a good 100 years in ways it shouldn't. Well, the lost cause did a similar thing here. So we're not honoring the lost cause, because that wasn't the Civil War. That wasn't even the Confederacy. That was a kind of rewriting of the history of those two things. And so
back to Rome.
We want to be careful. And so I think the Romans, you think, in some ways, are more accurate with their history. They're letting history opposed to rewriting it. Now, what has happened is, and I was laughing with some of the people I traveled with, because they're like, oh, this used to be pagan and now it's Christian. It's like, well, yeah, Christians came in and baptized the place. I mean, you know, it is no longer to the Roman God. It's now to God and Jesus and whoever. And yes, the Roman Catholics came in and baptized the whole dynamic. And that then speaks to what we've been dealing with in the news just this week with Pope Francis
yeah.
in Canada, which I find fascinating. And again, if you're ready, we can kind of get
into that. Yeah, let's go ahead.
Yeah, I think Pope Francis, what you're reading in the headlines, a couple of things I think you need to read through the headlines. Pope Francis went and apologized, and he was very emphatic, and rightly so, apologized for what happened in Canada. It also happened in the United States.
Right.
It wasn't just Canada. And he apologized for what and how it happened. Now, some people aren't satisfied. I mean, there are people who are criticizing and saying he has to revoke the doctrine of discovery. If you're not familiar with the doctrine of discovery, was the papal bull of 1493, 94, 95, sometime right after Christopher Columbus. That's how I can tether it. I know it's a little bit after 1493. 1992, we had the papal bull that said, hey, European rulers, go out and discover the world and take it over, and it'll be Christian, and it's yours. If you conquer it, it's yours. They haven't revoked that. Pope Francis didn't revoke that. I mean, give him, you know, he's still Pope of the Roman Catholic Church, and so, you know, the doctrine of discovery says, you know, well, what we know is a little bit better than what you know, and we're not going to say that's not true. I mean, you know, they're going to sit there and say, no, what we know about God and Jesus and Christianity and whatever pretty much supersedes what you might have known in your own indigenous communities. So Pope Francis has not revoked that, and I don't think he will revoke that. Now, part of, I don't know what his theological framework is, but I do know, and I discovered this when I was in Rome, you know, there are four kind of concepts that drive, theological concepts that drive Pope Francis and his decision making. And, you know, one of those is realities are more important than ideas. That's a philosophical piece that defines who he is. So he's not concerned about revoking the doctrine of discovery. He's more concerned about going and apologizing to the people of Canada. The reality of apologizing for the people of Canada is more important to him than the doctrine. We see that also with divorce. He would say people who are going through the divorce have a reality of divorce. We've got to minister to them in that reality versus changing the doctrine about marriage. LGBTQ people, we've got to realize this is their reality, and we've got to minister to them in their reality. We're not going to revoke the doctrine of what we may think here, because ideas are not as important as the realities of where people are. And so that's a huge philosophical piece, and there are three others, but that's
which
the main
opens,
one.
Which opens up the counter-argument that, my gosh, you're being a little hip, because how do we change the discrimination?
Good point.
And this and that, if we don't change the policy?
Good point. You know. I just know he also thinks that time is more important than space.
Right.
That's the terminology that he uses. So he wants to initiate process. Processes more so than winning a political argument. So he realizes that things won't be fulfilled during his lifetime, during his papacy, but he's going to initiate processes because he thinks time is more important than space. It's a fascinating philosophical concept, and that's just how he runs his papacy. And you know, the next pope may do very differently. So, you know, those are part of what define who he is and how he's defining the church.
We have a little bit of time, maybe about a minute, maybe, in this segment. What about the talk of him retiring?
Well, when I was in Rome, I had several meetings my first day in Rome. And so one meeting was with individuals who are responsible in what's known as the Dicastery of Integral Human Development. They are new employees there. They've only been there about a year. They don't know if they're going to have a job or not a month from now, because there are going to be some major restructuring things that will be announced during the month of August. It will be finalized, and they will then know if they have a job. But we had a fascinating conversation about biodiversity and the role of biodiversity and how we need to protect it on a global scale from that. The other thing I learned is, you know, Pope Francis is not thinking about resigning. I know the public statements have been, I think instead he's not going to travel as much. So he's going to tell folks that he can't make it over there. They've got to come see him in Rome. So I think traveling's the big issue. But I, from what I'm hearing on the inside with meetings that I had, he's staying until at least 2025. So we've got Pope Francis for another 3 years that will have continued significant influence on changing, because he's actually restructuring the Curia, which hasn't happened in hundreds of years. And so how that happens, how that unfolds, we'll see in the next 3 or 4 months.
All right, we got Pope Francis till 2025, and we got David Key for the rest of the hour on God Talk. You're listening to God Talk on The Voice and The Talk of Lake Oconee.
Thank you.
This is the voice of Lake Oconee, WDDK Greensboro, Madison, Eatonton, a proud member of the Oconee Radio Group.
Powered by BetterLocalRadio.com.
Doc 103.9.
I'm Karen McHugh. President Biden is back in isolation with a rebound case of COVID-19.
President Biden will be back in isolation for another 5 days. This comes after testing positive again for COVID-19. Mr. Biden's doctor says he has experienced no reemergence of symptoms and is continuing to feel quite well.
Fox's Ashley Strohmeyer. House Speaker Nancy Pelosi is leading a congressional delegation on a visit to the Indo-Pacific region, but she won't say if Taiwan is on the itinerary.
She won't give a firm answer about a potential trip to Taiwan. The White House won't give a firm answer either, but the Chinese Communist Party says do not go.
Well, I don't ever talk about my travel because, as some of you know, it's a security issue.
Troubling rhetoric from someone connected to Chinese state media who suggested shooting down House Speaker Nancy Pelosi's plane if she did, in fact, enter Taiwan airspace.
Fox's David Spunt. America is listening to Fox News.
If your family depends on your income and something happened to you, what would happen to them? You need life insurance, and SelectQuote can help you get it at a price you can afford.
SelectQuote found Jacob, 40, who's in excellent health, a 10-year, $500,000 policy for only $19 a month.
Not in perfect health? Don't worry.
SelectQuote found Tanya, 40, who has type 2 diabetes, a 10-year, $500,000 policy for only $32 a month.
We shop companies like Protective, Prudential, American General, and others to find you the company with the best rates. Give your family the security they need at a price you can afford.
For your free quote, call 1-800-881-4747. That's 1-800-881-4747. Or go to selectquote.com. That's 1-800-881-4747.
SelectQuote. We shop, you save.
Get full details on the example policies at selectquote.com/commercials. Your premium could vary depending on your health, issuing company, and other factors. Not available in all states.
Here's what's happening at Doc 103.9.
Atlas Ministry of Greene County will hold their annual golf tournament Monday, October 17th, with a shotgun start at 10 a.m. at the Oconee course at Reynolds Lake Oconee. To register, log on to atlasministry.org.
For more information, visit lakecountrytoday.com. In touch with the community. Doc 103.9.
If it's vacation time and you need more room on the road, see You Save Auto Rental on North Wayne Street in Milledgeville. They've got all sizes of vans for your vacation trip. Or if you need a rental replacement because you've been in a wreck, see your local hometown car rental agency in Milledgeville. You Save Auto Rental. They have the lowest rates in the Lake Country. So you really save big at You Save Auto Rental with free local pickup and delivery. The next time you need to rent a vehicle for whatever reason, see You Save Auto Rental inside Wilkinson Used Cars at 410 North Wayne Street in Milledgeville.
Hear that? That's how plumbing problems start. This is how they end. With a call to Grimes Plumbing. The Grimes family has been keeping the lake area flowing for four generations with trusted, reliable service for your home or business. Repairs, inspections, installations, we do it all. Just give us a call. Call Grimes anytime. Grimes Plumbing, 478-452-9175. That's 478-452-9175. Or visit llgrimes.com. Here's the latest Doc 103.9 forecast from the Georgia WeatherNet Storm Center.
Partly sunny skies today, scattered showers and thunderstorms likely. It will be hot and humid again, high 91, going to feel like 100. Tonight, partly cloudy skies, low 72. Tomorrow, mostly sunny, a few isolated thunderstorms in the afternoon and evening, high 92. Tuesday, mostly sunny skies, 30% chance of showers and thunderstorms, high around 92 again. Continued hot and humid Wednesday, scattered thunderstorms, high 93. From the Georgia WeatherNet, I'm KJ Allen.
It's 71 degrees at Doc 103.9, the voice of Lake Oconee. You're listening to God Talk, live on Doc 103.9, the voice of Lake Oconee.
And I'm Greg Tanum with Pastor David Key, founding pastor of Lake Oconee Community Church this time of year. That little church right there on the edge of Lake Oconee where Sunday morning worship service. And for those listening on the dock, you can join us even this morning if you're just having a cup of coffee somewhere and say, you know what, I want to have a start my morning with God and a good set of fellowship. Come on down right there at the Linger Longer Marina. We are talking about life and religious life, an experience that Pastor Reverend Key just had coming back from a heck of a trip. Italy, we were talking about Rome and what they're doing there as far as, appreciating their history as far as it relates to not only Roman culture, but also its influence on Christianity.
Well, and what the future looks like. I mean, I think what's fascinating to me about the whole piece is, again, we'll have a conversation as to how Christianity is looking in America these days. People are not going to church in Italy. They'll say that. They'll say, oh, you know, older people are going. I mean, almost similar to exactly what we're saying in this country. Older people are going. The young people are not in church. It's not as full as it has been. The difference is that Roman Catholicism is embedded in Italian culture. You know, every little town has a saint. And so whether you go to church or not, this is your town saint. And then there's some festival that goes insane. And the cathedrals are the main tourist attractions in every little town and in the city of Rome. And we're not the and again, it goes to the concept of beauty and how beauty gets played into it. Well, that really becomes part of the cultural ethos there, and it's very much part of Italian culture that even though folks may not be going to church, there's a heavy Christian Roman Catholic influence throughout it in ways that I'm not sure the United States has a similar trajectory. And that's the question mark, is Protestantism may not have that kind of embeddedness in culture the way Roman Catholicism is. And even now with our multi-religious interfaith dynamics happening presently, you know, I'm not sure Protestant Christianity... it's a fascinating analysis, and this kind of goes to a question you may want to ask, but may or may not. There's some analysis that, like in movies and in cultural pieces, Protestantism has disappeared.
Right.
The only pieces that are there now are Jewish religion and Roman Catholicism. You'll have a priest show up, you'll have a rabbi show up, but you'll never have a Protestant minister show up in movies and in cultural dynamics. And so you could argue that it already has been displaced from the greater culture, from Disney and from Sony, you know, from all the different media people. Protestantism is not presently even here. So fascinating conversations as to what moves forward. Now, politically, there are folks, you know, we call it Christian nationalism now, white Christian nationalism. There are people who are trying to embed that through the Supreme Court, through a political system. That's very different than doing it through beauty and doing it through education and doing it through health care, all those ways of influencing culture. Doing it politically is very short term. It can ebb and flow back and forth. You can have resistance against it. Whereas if you build a hospital, you build a school, you build a beautiful cathedral, that kind of lasts institutionally in ways that politics doesn't.
Good segue. I'll let you choose, though. This is, we take requests here. It's interesting because I have two pieces here on just what we're talking about, is religious dying in our country. And so here are the headlines. You pick which one you want to start with. Religious is dying, question mark. Don't believe it. Many of the nuns aren't secular. They belong to minority faiths. And then the other piece I got here is the backlash to Christianity. Some politicians are now panicked, but they only have themselves to blame.
And so the answer is yes and yes.
Well, which would you like to get into?
Well, you know, number one, I'm an optimist. And I do think the church can... I believe in the resurrection. I believe, and I think the church was birthed in the resurrection. And so I believe institutionally it can resurrect. Now, I've been listening to podcasts in addition to your two articles. I've been listening to lots of podcasts of what are we going to do about next Sunday? People aren't attending and all this. Let me tell you a few other things.
Open bar.
I heard one podcast that talked about how in the next 4 years we will lose 100,000 churches. And that's quite dramatic. 100,000 churches. And they talked about them being empty. You know, the churches will be empty. 100,000 churches, structures will be empty in 4 years because of the demographics. Only old people are there. Right. They'll die off. COVID might get them. I mean, who knows what the dynamics may be. But the young people aren't there to sustain those churches. And that may be true, probably is true. And yet, there are churches like ours that doesn't even have a church building.
Right.
And therefore, how will that regenerate with that? Now, other podcasts have talked about how folks show up at sweat lodges and, you know, community Bible studies, you know, the ladies' Bible study.
Walk on fire.
In a variety. But even in just Christian people, I know people women who are more devoted to their women's Bible study than they are showing up at 11 o'clock worship. That's not a criticism. I just think that's a change of where it is. If this is where they find their spiritual peace, then that's where they find it, and they don't feel a need. There is no longer a social pressure to show up for 11 o'clock church service. You know, one person said, you're not going to find your significant other at church. You're going to get it through eHarmony and through other web-based ways of hooking up with folks. So going and finding a spouse, which was one thing the church did for generations, you can find it now electronically. You don't need it. If you're going there for teaching, you know, people during COVID discovered that they could get on the internet and hear 4 or 5 really good teachers from all over the world with different things, and you can get your teaching done. And so the church is being a teaching has also been stripped thanks to COVID and thanks to, you know, modern technology. You know, the dynamic of being an altered space. When you've worked on the farm for 6 days, you dress up in your Sunday best to go to church to have something alternative to what your workplace is like. Churches have lost that to some degree. I do think we need to recapture that. People need to feel like they see God in church spaces, and then I think they'll come. If that's where they find God, they'll show up because there's something in us that needs that. So I think they'll show up. The other piece is, I think, is really about community and really genuine community. That's where I think the church has its greatest strength. But in a lot of places, it's lost it as well because people find their community in other ways. Or they're not willing to go to church and invest enough. They want to go to a big old church where nobody knows them and they're anonymous. And then kind of get in it. And yet they're not invested in the community the way I think churches could be. And really be them through the crisis of life, because you're going to have bad times. We're all going to have bad times. I mean, that's just the way life is. And church can be a really strong community to help you get through it. How do we need to restructure that is the real question. And how do we need to accentuate those pieces is what I think is the challenge for the church today.
Well, just sort of to wrap up and then point this all that the one about that well, don't believe religion is dying per se. It was by Byron Johnson and Jeff Levin. I think they're at Baylor University. But one of their conclusions here is that one of their comments. According to a social survey, 6.4% of self-described atheists and 27.2% of agnostics attended religious service monthly or more, 12.8% and 58.1% respectively prayed at least weekly, 19.2% life after death, 7.3%, 23% reported having a religious experience. In other words, religion, as you just said, continues to evolve. It isn't necessarily that. Yes, perhaps the traditional brick and mortar.
Well, or showing up at 11 o'clock on Sunday morning. Yeah. Church attendance, that was another podcast. You know, that we need to quit counting that as success.
Right.
That we need to find other ways of measuring success beyond just how many people are in the pew on Sunday morning. We need to measure success in new ways. Now, what ends up happening, one of the pieces that the podcast said, is sometimes we then don't measure success at all. So we're not doing any measurements because, you know, we decided that's not a measurement of success. And that's wrong. We need to be measuring. We need to be seeing how effective, what influence we're having. But we need to find new ways to measure that piece. Now, the Baylor folks are my people. I mean, that's where I grew up. I mean, that was, you know, I almost attended Baylor University when I was a teenager. Thought about going there briefly, and then I went off to Athens and had too much fun and said, to heck with Baylor. But anyway.
Beautiful. downtown Waco.
But those are still my people, and I know those people. And it's very much an individualized religion base.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, if you know anything about Southern Baptists, if you know anything about Baptists in general, it's a very kind of individualized conversionist way of doing church that's not collective as much as it is individualistic. And so they come with a very clear understanding of that individualism within Christianity, which is very different than what I've been talking about with Roman Catholicism in Rome. They're very collective. We're very individualistic, at least in evangelical Baptist circles. Now we see it in non-denominational churches all across the country. It's a very individualistic piece. And yeah, the individualistic piece is surviving because people need it, and they'll find it in alternative ways in the internet, in other communities. I think there's that side of it. But then there's a real challenge in the scriptures of, is that really authentic Christianity in the long run if you're not in a community, a communitarianism? Because we've talked about this on previous shows. We've got to find more communitarianism, and that is the Christian message for the whole country, is we've got to find village, we've got to find parish, we've got to find tribe. We've got to find that way to solve all those mass killings and everything we've talked about in previous weeks. And that's where Christianity comes in, because they talk about that stuff in the scriptures. We're just not really following it at the moment.
And we will continue the conversation on God Talk. Our number to call is 706-453-4140. This is God Talk on the voice and the talk of Lake Oconee.
Lindsay with Farmers and Merchants Bank, asking you to let us help make managing your finances a breeze this year with Farmers and Merchants Bank's e-banking services. From online, mobile, and telephone banking to mobile deposit capture and online transferring capabilities, we have you and your bank accounts covered. For more information on FMB's e-banking services, please visit ibankfmb.com or give us a call at 706-485-9941. Farmers and Merchants Bank, member FDIC, equal housing lender.
There's only one Top Flight Power Washing, the local, dependable, experienced, and affordable guys to get it like new clean. Power washing houses, driveways, walkways, docks, decks, and more. They wash windows inside and out. Stains on tin and shingle roofs disappear. Top Flight repairs woodwork and paints inside and out. They're prompt, respectful, licensed, and insured, and give free estimates. If you want it done right, call Top Flight. Top Flight Power Washing, 706-817-8869. That's 706-817-8869.
There's nothing like hearing the songs you love on local radio with no subscriptions and no monthly fees. But there's a new bill in Congress that could stop the music. If passed, this bill would tax your local radio station simply to play the music you love. Text LOCAL to 52886 and ask Congress to support local radio stations. Help us keep you connected to the music, local news, weather, and traffic that you need each day. This message furnished by the National Association of Broadcasters.
Madison Square Collection is a locally owned, Madison-based clothing boutique for women that carries exclusive brands of women's boutique clothing, jewelry, gifts, and accessories. Names that include Simply, Flax Linen, Hobo Leather Goods, Habitat, Susan Shaw Jewelry, and more. Madison Square Collection offers the latest fashions and signature finds to help define and express your unique style. Gift certificates are available. Madison Square Collection on Main Street in downtown Madison, across from the post office. Follow them on Facebook and Instagram.
Great Clips is your hometown hair salon, keeping everyone in the family looking great and being safe. Featuring professional stylists that listen and get you looking good 7 days a week, all with rigorous salon sanitation and safety procedures in place. With three close by locations, there's always a Great Clips near you in Milledgeville, Covington, and now in Watkinsville. And you can skip the wait, sign in online, or use the Great Clips app. It's gonna be great.
At Amelia's, we've got this great song stuck in our head.
Here comes the sun.
And that means fun, bright colors, fancy pants, and unique embroidery. Hi, this is Kim from Amelia's in Five Points in Athens and on Main Street in Madison. Whether your destination is island and margarita or just a summer spot at home, these styles will take you to a vacation state of mind. It's Amelia's for everything, from the classical to the whimsical and everything in between. And remember, if you think it looks good in our mirror, wait till you see it in yours.
You're listening to God Talk, live on Doc 103.9, the voice of Lake Oconee.
And I'm Greg Tanum, along with the Reverend David Key, founding pastor of Lake Oconee Community Church, our little church right there on the water by the Linger Marina. David, back from a trip to, throughout Italy, throughout
the Mediterranean, the Adriatic Sea. Yeah.
And talking about looking from the outside into the United States. Well, to our events in our societies, even into Lake Country. And they are experiencing, as we are in this country these days, some bizarre, and in some cases, some are suggesting historical kind of weather. So here's a headline for you. Mm-hmm. Could the climate crisis make religion even crazier? Let me read a couple of lines here. Of heat and the flooding all over the world. This particular author said, I'm finding that the first thing I end up talking with anyone about, no matter where the person is from, is the weather. And then almost every time the conversation is how crazy. And there's a book out called, he says, what if it all comes together that it's crazy, but something's happening in the nation and it's affecting the church. And the book is called Climate, Catastrophe, and Faith, How Changes in Climate Drive Religion Upheaval. And basically saying these kind of crises sometimes have a significant influence on people's interpretation of religion.
So, as far as my trip is concerned, they were having a heat wave. I mean, it was hot. I don't like to sweat, and I learned that my sweat glands are still working really well all throughout, especially Malta. Were the two main pieces that they are feeling the extreme heat and are talking about the extreme heat. It's interesting religiously. When I was at the Vatican, meeting with the folks who are handled biodiversity, probably 4 weeks earlier, maybe 2 months earlier, I'm not really sure. There's a guru from India called Sagaru who has a ashram up in Tennessee that folks may or may not be aware of. But Sagaru has traveled the world in the last four soil and the dynamics of us losing the nutrients in soil, which I find fascinating. I think that's true. I mean, if you've tasted tomatoes from some grocery store, they have no taste because they have no nutrients. They have especially no acid as part of that's why you know when someone's grown a tomato in rich soil, it has to be rich soil with lots of acid. You taste it. You can actually taste the difference, especially in tomatoes. Had that in Europe with watermelon and various melons and different things that you really tasted in ways we've lost here in this country. But Sakaru's been traveling the world talking about soil and just enhance the statistics about the lack of nutrients in our soils. And so people are not getting the nutrients they need, even if they're a vegetarian diet or whatever diet may be. It doesn't have the same potency the previous vegetables and previous generations had. Now, farmers know that. I mean, local farmers know that you got to rotate the soil. You've got to put stuff in the soil, and I mean they're very aware of those dynamics. But religiously, the reason why I'm saying this, these people I met with at the Vatican had met with Sagaru. He had come. They met. They had conversations, basically dealing with soil. And some of those conversations will occur when the United Nations has its next climate change conference in Cairo, Egypt. November, COP27, and then there's COP15, which is dealing with biodiversity. Those two meetings will be happening later this fall, and you will have more kind of conversations coming out about all of that. And there is a religious overtone that's happening among that. Now, Christians are somewhat threatened by language with Mother Earth, and whenever they do kind of Gaia language and Mother Earth, that's becoming part of the controversy. And the Roman Catholic Church is now language about how they're going to respond to biodiversity in that language and that environmental movement. They're having those conversations, and the Secretary of State has not come out with the official document yet, but the people underneath have sent information up the ladder, so we're waiting to see what they come up with. Roman Catholicism, and again, because they have a structure with Pope Francis, he can think about global issues. Us Baptists, us Methodists, us Presbyterians, us Lutherans, even the Anglicans, because the Archbishop of Canterbury has not been thinking. You know, the Pope has come out with a heavy environmental piece because he thinks globally. And other churches follow in based on his lead. He had a meeting last fall that religious leaders representing 84% of the religious people in the globe met and signed off on a document. So, yeah, it already is meeting those kind of religious pieces. Where have we had representatives of 84% of the global population? Where have we had that before? We haven't.
Yeah.
And so, you know, so, yeah, it is impacting those ways in a lot of different ways, you know, that some will see as positive and some as negative.
Well, we're back to Baylor here. This is Philip Jenkins. Baylor wrote this book. He contends that catastrophes and upheavals, including those prompted by climate, often result in an uptick in conspiracy theories and scapegoating.
Sure. Yeah. And so you're going to have those pieces, and there's going to be power dynamics. One of the things that we have to realize is the people, especially in places that, you know, Latin America and Africa and other places, that discoveries of various biodynamics that we then bring to this country and manufacture, you know, there are just some justice issues that have to be discussed and all that as well. Philip Jenkins is also the individual who's the first to tell us 40 years ago that the church was moving to Africa. He's a missiologist. This is his background. Great guy. Said, hey, the church is headed to Africa, and we've got to kind of deal with that dynamic. And we've seen that. We've seen it happening. The church has been exploding in Africa compared to the Western countries. And the seat of the church is headed to that way. And so how that gets addressed, they're dealing with it at the Lambeth Conference among the Anglicans.
Right.
Roman Catholicism deals with it on a regular basis. And then other denominations have split away from it. The Methodists are having to deal with the dynamic of how connected will they be with Africa once everything pans out with their division happening. So, yeah, you know, it is there.
Okay, as you start dealing with jet lag, you're in the pulpit in a half hour from now.
Oh, yes.
So let's talk about, we got just a little bit of time, maybe a minute.
Okay.
Scripture and sermon.
Well, basically, from Luke, we're going to be looking at when the disciples asked Jesus, Lord, teach us to pray. And he talks about prayer. So we're going to be looking at the dynamics around prayer. It is interesting in how Jesus responded to their request. He didn't give them a formula or anything that kind of dealt with that. He actually had certain texts, and we'll go through the text briefly to see what was significantly pointed out in the prayers. I think the Lord's Prayer is the comprehensive prayer for any Christian, and if you're at the most basic level of Christianity, doing the Lord's Prayer can be the best discipline that you can have on a regular basis. Some call it the Our Father, but doing that on a regular basis, if you'll incorporate those, you have a comprehensive prayer that's there, and then we'll just talk about how Jesus interacted with that and what he taught us about prayer.
Well, glad you're back in the USA.
It's good to be back. Again, I love the Lake Oconee area. I love the Athens area, and I'm just glad to be home. It's good to be back.
And you're hearing Reverend David Key on The Dock, the voice of Lake Oconee and the talk of Lake Oconee.
Day by day.
Listening to God Talk with the Reverend David Key and Greg Tanham. God Talk is a production of the Oconee Radio Group.